morning, it's good to be here. We got a little bit of a technical hitch this morning in that the projector isn't working. So I'm afraid if you wish you can remember the hymns, you'll be having just to listen this morning and not just be able to mouth the words to yourself, because we're not going to be able to pray. I usually put the reading up and some heads and so forth. Well, that won't happen today, unfortunately, not this morning, but tonight, God willing, it will happen in the chapel because we've got TV screens. We're really gone modern, so we've got the screen, so that should hopefully be working this evening. We'll meet tonight as normal at 6 o'clock at the mission, and then on Wednesday this week we have our prayer meeting at 7:15. This week, what we've been doing over the last couple of months is we've been having our communion service on a Wednesday, and just because it's easier probably, and people, if people do turn up on a Sunday, it'll be a bit awkward. So what we're doing, we're having our communion service on a Wednesday during the prayer meeting. And if you decide to come, then you need to just take a little bit of bread, not a loaf, not even a whole slice, just a little bit of bread, and we'll provide the wine. But it saves us having to handle the bread and so forth. So that'll be on Wednesday evening at 7:15. God willing, next Lord's Day in the morning, again at 10:45, we'll be here and back in the mission in the evening. I did mention last week that we'd made a gift, but the gift I mentioned had gone to the wrong place if I was right, which I wasn't. I was corrected. It wasn't for Murph, it was for Aisha Link. And we actually, as a church, we gave £200 towards the fact that they want to use a scooter to be able to evangelize on, and it costs around about £1,000. There were other gifts that were given, so it ended up we sent £280 to Aisha Link. So we can give God thanks for that. Also, there are those who aren't well. I've spoken to Gwyneth a couple of times. I'd half thought I might have been able to go see her yesterday because she's on the ground floor. And I thought if I went outside and could speak to her through the window, which I think Sally may have done. But anyway, the lady who was on wasn't overly keen on that idea. She did say they're in lockdown, so I didn't know what that meant. They were in lockdown like everybody is, or whether they've got a special lockdown at the moment. So I wasn't quite sure. So I haven't been able to see Gwyneth, but I have been able to speak to her a couple of times on the phone. Mrs. Guest, we saw Mrs. Guest yesterday in the garden, well, just on the entrance to her garden. She was walking about, but she had another fall, which is, this time it was David who'd fallen. He'd fallen into a bush, and she went to help him, and then she fell in as well. And she thinks she's cracked her ribs by the sound of things. So she's just about able to walk. She got cracked ribs, and you still don't hear her complaining. She just kind of gets on with things, and she's got her hands full with Dave as well, because Dave isn't totally mobile and well. So, you know, we can remember Jean, as I said we would, and Gwyneth in our prayers, and others that are unable to gather with us at the moment. So I think that's all the announcements. We will pray. We'll bow our heads and pray now. So, Father in heaven, we come as your people to worship you. We know that you delight in the praises of your people, and we've come with that desire in our hearts. But you know the situations that we're in. You know things are different to what we normally would have in our services. And yet you know our hearts. You know the desires of our hearts, and we want to glorify your name even this day. And so we ask that you'd help us. We pray that you'd aid us by your gracious Holy Spirit. Help us, we pray, Lord, to take this time to stop and to meditate upon you, to give you all the praise that is due your name, that through everything that we do, we may be able to see it as that which we're doing for your glory. We ask as we look at your word that you'd help us to understand it and apply it to our own situations. We thank you for this wonderful avenue of prayer that you've given to us, which now is open to us through our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And when we come before your throne, we know that we have one in heaven who sits at your right hand, who intercedes on behalf of his people, and we're thankful that we can come in his name and through his merits even this day. We realize that also you know our situations, you know the things that perhaps are on our minds and can easily distract. And so we ask, Lord, that you give us that peace which passes all understanding as we meditate upon you. We pray for those going through difficult times. There are many through our land who are having terrible times over these last months. We think of India with all the terrible things that are happening there at this moment in time. We pray for those that we know are working in particular areas in India. We ask that you'd use them for the furtherance of the gospel, even in the midst of all the difficulties that they're knowing at this time. And Heavenly Father, we pray for this money that has gone to Asia Link, and we pray that it'll be used to be able to evangelize the areas that these men are working in. And Heavenly Father, we pray for those in our own church, those who are going through difficult times. We remember Gwyneth to you. We pray you will be with her. We realize that she has been 10 weeks in hospital without really seeing anyone. And we just pray that you will be with her and draw near to her, that she'll find you to be the one who is her comforter and her strength. And Father, we pray also for Mrs. Guest. We thank you for her. We realize the difficulties that she's knowing at this time. We just pray that you'll give her wisdom and help and strength, and that again she will know what it is, even in the quietness of her own home, to worship and to praise you. Father, we pray for our land. We pray for those that rule over us. We pray for this day in which we live, and we would long for it to be a day when people will start to think seriously about their standing before you, and they may be turning to you in our villages, in our towns and cities, up and down the land. And so, Father, we pray you will be with us and you bless us, and your hand will be upon us for good, even this day. For we ask this in your name. Amen. So we're going to have a hymn. We can listen to it. It's My God, How Wonderful Thou Art. Through Exodus, and we've been looking at the life of Moses. What we're probably going to do over the next few weeks, Sunday mornings, we'll actually skip a lot and just pick out some important points now in the remaining journey of Israel to the promised land. But this morning, what we're going to think about is the Day of Atonement. So we're actually going to be reading from Leviticus this morning, Leviticus chapter 16 and verses 1 through to 22. Leviticus 16, 1 to 22. Now the Lord spoke to Moses after the death of the two sons of Aaron, when they offered profane fire before the Lord and died. And the Lord said to Moses, Tell Aaron your brother not to come at just any time into the holy place, into the veil, before the mercy seat which is on the ark, lest he die. For I will appear in the cloud above the mercy seat. Then Aaron shall come into the holy place with the blood of a young bull as a sin offering and of a ram as a burnt offering, and he shall put the holy linen tunic and the linen trousers on his body, and he shall be girded with a linen sash, and with a linen turban he shall be attired. These are the holy garments. And therefore he shall wash his body in water and put them on, and he shall take them from the congregation of the children of Israel, two kids of the goats as a sin offering, and one ram as a burnt offering. Aaron shall offer the bull as a sin offering, which is for himself. He will make atonement for himself and for his house. And then he shall take the two goats and present them before the Lord at the door of the tabernacle of meeting. Then Aaron shall cast lots for the two goats, one lot for the Lord and the other lot for the scapegoat. And Aaron shall bring the goat, which is the Lord's, on which the Lord's lot fell, and offer it as a sin offering. But the goat on which a lot fell to be the scapegoat shall be presented alive before the Lord, to make atonement upon it, and to let it go as the scapegoat into the wilderness. And Aaron shall bring the bull of the sin offering, which is for himself, and make atonement for himself and for his house, and shall kill the bull as the sin offering, which is for himself. And then he shall take a censer of full burning coals of fire, which the Lord before, coals of fire, from the altar before the Lord, which his hand, with his hand full of sweet incense, beaten fine, and bring it into inside the veil. And he shall put the incense on the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of incense may cover the mercy seat that is on the testimony, lest he die. He shall take some of the blood of the bull and sprinkle it with his finger on the mercy seat on the east side, and before the mercy seat he will sprinkle some of the blood with his finger seven times. And then he shall kill the goat of the sin offering, which is for the people. Bring its blood inside the veil. Do with the blood as he did with the blood of the bull, and sprinkle it on the mercy seat and before the mercy seat. So he shall make atonement for the holy place, because of the uncleanness of the children of Israel, and because of the transgressions for all their sins. And so he shall do for the tabernacle of meeting, which is remains among them in the midst of their uncleanness. There shall be no man in the tabernacle of meeting when he goes in to make atonement in the holy place, until he comes out, that he may make atonement for himself, for his household, and for the assembly of Israel. He shall go out to the altar that is before the Lord, and make atonement for it, and take some of the blood of the bull and some of the blood of the goat, and put it on the horns on the altar around, and then he shall sprinkle some of the blood on it and his finger seven times, cleanse it and consecrate it from the uncleanness of the children of Israel. And when he had put an end of atonement for the holy place, the tabernacle of meeting, and the altar, he shall bring the live goat. Aaron shall lay both hands on the head of the live goat, confess all the iniquities of the children of Israel and all their transgressions concerning all their sins, putting them on the head of the goat, and he shall send it away into the wilderness by the hand of a suitable man. The goat shall bear it on itself, all their iniquities, to go to an uninhabited land, and he shall release the goat in the wilderness. So a little bit of a complicated reading, but hopefully by the end we'll understand a little bit more. Thank you, Jen. Well, Brother Dad, girls, now then I can see that you're already starting on the project, which will give you a clue as to what we're saying. I don't know how many of you have ever been on boats. I've been on quite a few big boats, and that's fine. I've been on a couple of small boats, that's not so fine, because they bounce around an awful lot, and I'm not a big fan of bouncing around on the ocean. But the big boats, they're usually pretty safe. But sometimes, I've read, they can find themselves not on the sea, but on the land. For some reason, they can't stay on the water, and they've drifted onto the land. And usually there's a reason behind it. And the most common reason is that the anchor has broken. The anchor has stopped working. It's either broken in the chain, or it's come off in the seabed, and it can't hold the ship steady, and the ship drifts and drifts and drifts until it ends up on the shore. It's a very unreliable thing, the anchor. When it breaks, the ship is all over the place. What we know about our God is that He, to His people, those who trust Him, He's an anchor. He's an anchor. And in the book of Hebrews, it says, "This hope we have as an anchor for the soul, both sure and steadfast." The ship's anchor is not sure and steadfast all the time, but our God is sure and steadfast. No matter what we go through, and no matter what happens, we look to Him as our hope and as our anchor. So when you make your anchors today, and when you take them home, you can remember the anchor keeps the ship safe if it can, but it breaks. But the anchor that God is to His people never breaks. He is sure and steadfast. Well, I actually know that the girls know a little bit about anchors, don't you, Abby? Because their dad goes on the lifeboat in Tempe quite a bit. Have you been on the lifeboat, you girls, have you? Yeah, she got through your head. So they know a little bit about boats and anchors, yeah? That's good, thank you very much. So this morning, as I said, we're looking at the Day of Atonement, really. We're going to be considering, as I said, one or two particular situations that are confronted by the children of Israel when they go through the wilderness into the Promised Land. But here they've been given instructions. And we're going to look at this idea of the Day of Atonement, the Day of Atonement. The Day of Atonement, really, some people have abbreviated it by saying it means at-one-ment. In other words, it's the means by which someone can be reconciled to someone. An atonement has to be paid or has to be made. And so we have this idea in the scriptures that Christ has become our means of atonement, our means of covering what we've done wrong, and our means of reconciling us to God, of making us right with God. So that's what we're thinking about this morning, the atonement. If you had the heads up there, they would say this. We're going to think about a temporary system and meeting place, and then we're going to think about a temporary solution, and then we're going to think about a permanent temple and solution. So those are the three things that we're going to focus on this morning. So Leviticus chapter 16, much of what has taken place in the Old Covenant, much of what has been spoken of in the Old Testament, if you want, is explained in the New Testament. But much of what has taken place in the Old Testament was really only temporary. That's why we haven't got that big performance here this morning. That's why we haven't got high priests, and we haven't got sacrifices, and we haven't got all the garb that they would have worn in those days. So it was a temporary system. It was a temporary place of meeting, the tabernacle or the temple. So Hebrews, in the book of Hebrews, we read a lot in the book of Hebrews about the things that took place in the Old Testament, and it begins to explain what was the significance of them. So it tells us about the priesthood, it tells us about the temple, it tells us about the sacrifices, about the laws, about the clothing which they wore, and so forth. And so much of Hebrews really is explaining to us the relevance of these things, because, well, they were only temporary, they were only for a time. Moses was commanded to build this wonderful tabernacle. There was to be this fence around the area. So every time they camped, they would set up this area within the middle of the camp, and all the other tents of the camp would be around this particular area that was set up. So there was, if you want, three sections. There was this outer area, this outer perimeter or fence, which was made of animals' clothes, and which was made of animal skins, I should say. And it was a certain length and a certain width, and it was what we call the outer court. And what we know about the outer court is that was made so that the children of Israel could be in the vicinity of what was going on, but they couldn't totally encroach on everything. within the outer court, there was the altar for the burnt offerings. There was a, we would say, a place to wash your hands or to wash. There was a laver. So there in the outer court, you've got the laver and you've got the altar. And then we know that there was a courtyard which was inside of that area. And this was the area, if you want, of the tabernacle. And it, again, it was made of, it had skins over it. They had no refinements like we've got today. So they had animal skins. And they made a roof which was made out of purple and blue with strands of gold embroidered into all this. And there was this over the roof of this particular tabernacle. There was actually three layers of skins which were placed over this inner area. And inside there was, I mentioned before, there was the lampstand with the seven containers on it, the lampstand. There was a table for the showbread. There was 12 loaves on there for each of the 12 tribes. And really, this was the area where only the priests could go into. But then there was this other area. It was called, this one called just the holy place. This was the Holy of Holies. So within this courtyard, you had the tabernacle. You had a section with inside the tabernacle, which the priest could go to. But then you had this one area, which only one person could go into. It was the most holy of place. And inside this place, inside there, the Holy of Holies, was the Ark of the Covenant, which we've spoken about before, which was made up of, in a certain size, by certain wood. It was overlaid in gold. It had cherubims on the top of it. It had within it the tablets of stone whereupon the Ten Commandments were written. It had Aaron's rod, which is budded. It had the pot of manna and so forth. And there was on the top this gold, and it was shaped something like a seat. And it was called the mercy seat. And this was to be a symbol, if you want, of where God would come and he would presence himself here on the earth. This is where God could be met. This is where, in many ways, it was like a king's throne. There in this little area was this place. It was shaped a bit like a seat. And that's where God would meet with the person who he'd appointed. It was the meeting place, if you want. And it was a symbol of where heaven and earth could meet. At the mercy seat. At the Ark of the Covenant. There, they could meet with God. They could meet with God, as would have been the position which had happened prior to Adam and Eve falling in the garden. And much of what takes place and much of the symbolism actually goes back to the Garden of Eden. It reminds us of what things should have been like. It reminds us of that idea that there was a way whereby God would actually meet with Adam and Eve in the garden right at the beginning of time. And then something happened, sin interrupted that position, and they were driven out of the garden. And there, as there was embroidered on the curtain outside, was the cherubims. There was the angels at the gates of the Garden of Eden. No one was allowed in. They were not allowed back because sin had separated Adam and Eve from that fellowship with God. So there was that barrier which had come, if you want. And now the high priest was going to be able to go in once a year and have this union with God. But it was only a temporary system. It was only a temporary place whereby they could meet. And then this became the temporary solution. How could God meet man when sin had entered into the world? Well, the tabernacle was the temporary situation. It was where God would presence himself on this planet. He would come into that particular section of the world. He would enter into the tent. He would come to the mercy seat. And only the high priest could meet with him once a year. So it was a temporary situation. But it was also a temporary solution. This was how God was going to come and be reconciled and be able to meet where it had once been the case in the Garden of Eden. Now, to go into the presence of God in the Old Testament, you had to go through, or the priest had to go through, a great deal of procedure. He had to go through particular washing. He had to go through a particular ritual. He had to bring the right animals with him so that they could be sacrificed and presented. And he was outwardly washed to show symbolically that you need to be cleansed to be in the presence of God. Now we know when we come to the New Testament that cleansing has to be inward. And that's what we're going to be thinking about shortly. But the high priest would actually spend around 7 days getting himself right to be able to enter on that one day of atonement into the inner sanctuary, if you want. He would wear the appropriate clothing when he went in there. He could enter in because he was cleansed and because he was carrying out exactly what God had said to him. Now, we have a great high priest. We're going to be thinking about him shortly, the Lord Jesus Christ. And some people might have thought, well, do you know, if I dressed and I washed and I had all these things, I could actually surely go into the presence of God in the inner sanctum. They wouldn't have been allowed. They would have died under the judgment of God. Some people actually think, and many, many, many people believe in Jesus Christ that he existed. Some people study his life and study his work. And they admire what he's done. And he's a grand example for humanity in how to live and how to conduct oneself. And some people may say, well, if we just use Jesus' example, the great high priest to follow, then surely God will be with us. If we go through the right procedures and we do the right things, as long as we obey his commandments, the problem being this. Do you know what? If you could live today and keep all of God's commandments, that would only be temporary. Because tomorrow, or the next day, or whenever, I will guarantee you, you will fail. I will not be able to keep God's standards. If we were to look at the Ten Commandments, we could say, well, the first part of the table is very hard, to have one God and to have no other. But then come to the second half of the table, I could surely keep the commandments. I mean, I'm not going to murder anybody. I'm not going to commit adultery. I'm not going to steal. I'm going to honor my parents. All of those sort of things we could say. And you may be able to go through life thinking, well, we've managed to do that. And then we come to the 10th commandment. And it says, we shall not covet. And then we have to stop and think, well, that isn't just about what I do. It's about what I'm doing in here, in my heart. It's about not coveting what somebody else has, not being jealous of what somebody else has. It's about not looking at somebody else's partner, if you want, and having something within inside you which is coveting them. Or not being that angry with somebody that inside you could actually rattle them and give them that. Because Jesus says, what's going on in here is exactly what God sees. And if you commit adultery in the inward, you almost committed in the outward. If you committed murder against somebody, you could have killed that person, and you've thought that in your heart, he says, that's the same as if you've done it. So, 1 John tells us, do you know what? Our hearts condemn us. We know in our heart we cannot keep the standards that God has required. And there was no one could say, I'll follow the example of the priest and I'll do exactly. Because God wasn't going to accept that. That was only a temporary means, but it was a means that God had laid down. God had said, there's a standard whereby we need to keep. And try to do our best and try to follow that. You can only do it for a short time. That's only a temporary thing you'll be able to do or I'll be able to do. So some people say, well, you know, as long as I go to church, surely I'll be okay with God. Well, you might get through Sunday and do very well. Then tomorrow you might be totally different. So it's been a temporary solution for one day, but it isn't going to face the situation that God is confronting you with, your sin before him. Now Hebrews and chapter 9 tells us this, that for us to be accepted with God, there has to be the shedding of blood. Because it says, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. So it isn't just about keeping a standard. It isn't just about trying to do our best. It isn't about trying to follow the example of the Lord Jesus Christ or other people. It's actually about the fact that our sin needs to be dealt with. And blood has to be shed. Because without the shedding of blood, there can be no forgiveness of sins. So the old system was only temporary. It was pointing towards something which was going to be permanent. Now, in any system in our land, for instance, so you wonder sometimes if it's the same today, but we're supposed to have systems which will deal with situations justly. So when someone does something wrong, well, if they commit the crime, they must do the time, we say. In other words, when someone does something wrong, the punishment must be meted out which will be proportional to what they've done. So to put things right, there has to be payment. There has to be that which has been passed. So on the Day of Atonement, it speaks about the fact that there is a way back to God. It speaks about blood as being the means whereby life comes. The Bible talks about the fact that blood is the symbol of life. Because when blood starts to pour out, then you're going to die unless you stop that wound, aren't you? That's why we got blood transfusions. That's why we give blood. So that people, when they're losing blood, can actually get blood back into their system. That's why when someone cuts themselves, we try to wrap over as quick as they can and squeeze it or whatever. I remember in my day playing rugby a number of times, I cut some of the eye. In those days, they had no substitute. So what they used to do, they used to squeeze you. So that's why it goes scars on my eyes. They used to squeeze it as long as they could and then pile a lot of Vaseline on it and send you back on. But it was the means of actually trying to stop the blood flowing out, because the life is in the blood. So sin needs to be judged. There needs to be that which is proportional to what has taken place. In the Old Testament, it required the shedding of blood. There was a temporary system of dealing and if you want, staying the justice that should be poured out. So once a year, this high priest, he went into the tabernacle, he went into the temple. He goes into the one place on earth where God was going to meet personally with him. He had to make a sacrifice for himself. He had to make a sacrifice for the people. And he'd come into that particular area, but he was also to take two goats with him. And he was to cast lots for which goat was actually going to be sacrificed. He would take the two goats, symbolically he would lay his hands upon them, and he was showing really that what's going to happen now is that they're going to actually meet God's requirements. So he goes into the holiest of holies, one goat has been put to death, and then he's put his hand on the other goat, symbolically showing that now the sins of the people and my sins are going to be placed on this other goat. The one goat, the blood would be taken and it would be sprinkled on the altar, on the mercy seat. And then the other one then was to be taken. And he was to be called the scapegoat, which we've all used that term, I suppose. Somebody said, well, he's just become a scapegoat for what's taken place. Well, the Lord had laid on him the iniquities. The Lord has laid on him, Isaiah 53 says, the iniquities of us all. That would have been symbolically that poor little goat. But in Isaiah 53, it's actually talking about Jesus. And it's saying that God has laid on Jesus the sins of us all. Just like that scapegoat. Leviticus tells us there was a man chosen in verse 22 of Leviticus 16. A man was chosen, and we find that when the sin offering had been made, the sacrifice had been made, we find that the high priest had gone into into the inner sanctum. Now, sin had separated mankind from God. When Adam and Eve fell, there was that barrier that had come between God and man. And in the beginning of the Bible, in Genesis, what we know is that then, even at the beginning of time, an animal had to be put to death. Because we know that the animal died so that they could be clothed. They were naked. They found themselves to be naked. And the animal would be the means of clothing and covering their nakedness. So blood had to be shed right back in the beginning of time. Now the high priest is shedding blood on behalf of the people. Now the high priest is symbolically putting his hand upon the goat's head to take the sins of the people away. The high priest, I'm told that the idea behind that word in the Latin is to be a bridge maker. The high priest was like a bridge maker. So the priesthood, the tabernacle, the sacrifices, all that was going on so that there could be that bridge made whereby God could cover sin and he could meet with mankind. Now, God is a God of love, and we must never ever put that to aside. God is a God of love, but he's also a God of justice. And he has to find a way, or he had to find a way, whereby love could actually cover the just demands of what was required. So the people needed a high priest. They needed a high priest to be the go-between, to cover, to do what was required. Hebrews 8 talks about the fact that he became the mediator between God and between the people of God. So in the Old Testament, blood, bulls, of lambs, of goats, they were all shed, and the high priest was significant. The thing about the high priest in the Old Testament was this. The high priest was no different to you and me in one sense. Because whatever happened with the high priest, it happens to everybody at some time. Hebrews chapter 7 and verse 23 says this. Remember, Hebrews is explaining what's taking place. So in Hebrews chapter 7 verse 23 it says, also there were many priests because they were prevented by death from continuing. So that means this. The first high priest was not the last high priest because they died. Someone took over. Someone followed in their line. And so they got old like the rest of us are getting old. They had problems in their body. They began to know the difficulties of age. And eventually they died and they were removed. And so the Day of Atonement, another high priest would have to have stepped in so that he could do the work of the bridge to bring the love of God to cover over the justice of God. But the high priests were also very similar to us in many ways. Not only would they die, but they needed to make an offering for their sin because the high priest was not perfect. Now, if you can think of the best minister you've ever known, I don't think you stand at the front, but if you can think of the best minister you've ever known, I will guarantee you that minister had failings. He had something about his character or something about what he did in his life. Because there is no perfect minister. There's no one who is at their best perfect. Even the Pope, who the Catholic Church hold in absolute high esteem. I can guarantee you the Pope is like any of us. He fails. He makes mistakes. The Bible tells us that all that's going on here, which is temporary, was pointing to a permanent system and solution. Because Jesus Christ would come and he would fulfill all that was being pointed to. So in Romans chapter 3 and verse 25, he became the means of meeting God's justice. He became, the word used there is, the propitiation for our sins. And that basically means he took upon him what was our right so that he could become the bridge. He would take the wrath of God upon him so that that wrath need not come upon us, which justly should be upon us. And Hebrews chapter 8 and chapter 9, which it tells us the blood in the Old Testament was offered and it was pointing to this one final sacrifice who would be Jesus Christ. And the wonderful thing is, Christ's blood was shed to make atonement, to make us at one with God. And that means this, that it doesn't matter what we've done, the best minister has failed, the Pope has failed. But whatever we've done, however bad it was, there is forgiveness found with God through Jesus Christ. He's come to cover our sin, to pay the penalty so that we could be acquitted of our sins. You see, he was unlike the high priests in the Old Testament. In Hebrews chapter 7 again, in verse 27 and verse 28 there, it says this about Jesus. Now, he was different from these other priests. He doesn't need to daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifices, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people. For he did once for all when he offered up himself. For the law appoints a high priest men who have weaknesses, but the word of oath which came after the law appoints the Son who has been perfect forever. So you see, the best high priest in the Old Testament, the best priests would have failed. God appointed a high priest to be the bridge whereby we could come into his presence. So when the high priest finished his work, when he came into the work, into the place while he was working, he was busy. He was carrying out the wherewithal within the Holy of Holies. He was standing, carrying out his requirements within that area. When Jesus finished his work, Hebrews 10 and verse 11 and 12, it says this. And remember, this is explaining all these things to us. It says then in Hebrews 10, verse 11 and 12, and every priest, having ministered daily and offerings repeatedly, the same sacrifice, which can never take away sins, but this man, after he offered one sacrifice for sins, forever sat down at the right hand of God. That's significant. Because the priests were busy standing, carrying on, doing their work daily outside, and then once a year in the Day of Atonement within the Holy of Holies. They got to stand because that was they were in the office of working, and Jesus finished his great work of salvation. He goes back to heaven. Hebrews tells us, when he'd finished his work, sat down. It's over, he finished the work. He sat down at his Father's right hand. He took our sins. Hebrews 8 and verse 12 tells us, he took our sins, and he tells us he will remember them no more because he's covered them. He's passed over, he's taken the punishment for our sins. He's now become that bridge whereby we can enter into the presence of God. So you see, it's not just about rituals. It's not about laws. It's about the fact that we have one who has done all that was pointed in the Old Testament and has come to fulfill that. Hebrews 8 and verse 10. Again we read, for this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their mind. I will write them on their hearts. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Now, in the inner sanctum, in the Holy of Holies, was the Ten Commandments. It was written on stone. It was kept as a reminder within the Ark of the Covenant. In the New Testament, he says, I'm not going to put up things, plaques on the wall. I'm going to write these things on the heart of my people. I'm going to deal with that which is inward. It's not going to be outward. He's going to write them on our hearts. So we have one who's paid the price. Tonight we're going to be thinking about Jesus at the cross. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21 says, he made him who knew no sin to become sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. That's what he was about. This is the great high priest. This is the final sacrifice. He took our sins upon himself. He was the one who would be forsaken by God, so that we need never be forsaken by God. Tonight we'll think about that cry that goes out on the cross. My God, why have you forsaken me? And in some ways it reminds us they've taken this goat, and the sins of the people have been placed on the goat. And the goat is taken out into the wilderness, probably about 20 miles. And then it's left in the wilderness. It's forsaken. It's left out there. And it reminds us of the cry which Jesus makes. Why have you forsaken? Well, he was forsaken for our good. So we need never be forsaken. This was the permanent solution that God had. We don't need a temple now. We don't need to worry about a temple being built. We have a temple where God now chooses to dwell. In the Old Testament, it was a tabernacle, the tents, until they got into the promised land and Solomon built his wonderful temple. But there's one place where God dwells now, and it's not in the Holy of Holies anymore. He reveals himself now, not just to one man on the Day of Atonement. Jesus came into this world so that we don't need to worry about where God is. Is he there? He's on his heavenly throne. He's in heaven. But he also dwells amongst his people. So we believe in the third person of the Trinity. We believe that Jesus went back to heaven and the Holy Spirit was sent. And now the Holy Spirit, we thought about it Wednesday evening, he dwells in the hearts of his people. He dwells in the midst of his church. So I don't know how many we are this morning here. We're not many. You know, the wonderful thing is this, and it doesn't matter about the building now. The wonderful thing is this, is that we're two or three have gathered together in his name, he promises to be in the midst of them. So you see, when you see 12, he's not in the tabernacle. He's not coming down to the inner sanctum. The Holy Spirit now, God himself, dwells when his people meet together. He dwells amongst them. But also he dwells within their heart. He comes and he takes up residence in the life of people. Tonight we'll see. What actually happened also was when Jesus died, if you remember, there was the curtain that separates now the holy place and the Holy of Holies. And when the temple was built, it was the same. There was a huge curtain which only allowed the high priest to go into the Holy of Holies once a year on the Day of Atonement. Tonight we see when Jesus dies on the cross, a remarkable thing happens. This thick curtain suddenly begins to be ripped from top to bottom, and it parts. And suddenly, people can see and enter in to what they had never seen apart from the high priest before. Jesus Christ came into the world to open up the way into God's presence. He became our high priest. He's now our bridge. This is the love over the justice of God that allows us to walk or come into the presence of God. He is that bridge. And if we put our faith in him, and if we trust in him to remove our sin, we don't need goats, we don't need bulls, we don't need lambs, we don't need a priesthood, we don't need a wonderful building and ornate clothing. We need to realize that this has all been fulfilled. This is that which has now become permanent. He has a permanent temple. He has a permanent system. The temple is our heart. And the system is that he's laid down in his word how we are to worship him. And how we are to follow him. Now Martin Luther, he made this statement which, when you listen to the first of all, it sounds a bit strange. He said this: believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and do whatever you want. That sounds pretty liberal. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and do whatever you want. What Martin Luther meant by saying that was this: if you put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, you will want to do what he wants you to do. You want to know what his word has to say, and you want to know what are his requirements for me to walk the life that he'd have me to walk. So Martin Luther was right. We must believe in Christ and do what we want, because whatever we want should be what he would have us to do. If we'd been in the Old Testament on the Day of Atonement, we would have not seen what the high priest was doing. We'd have not seen the mercy seat. We'd not seen the normal plebs would not have seen all that was going on with the lampstand and the table and so forth, where the priests were. But now through God's word, all has been revealed to us. We can see now the mercy seat by faith. We can see now beyond the curtain. We can actually see what God was doing and what he's done. And we can see now that all of this now was just shadows which was pointing to the reality. So 1400 years or so before Jesus came, these things were just pointing to what he would be and what he would fulfill. So what does it mean for us? I'll read some portions before I close from Hebrews again. Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 9 to 11 there. Hebrews 9 verses 9 to 11. It was symbolic for the present time, in which both gifts and sacrifices are offered, which cannot make who performed those sacrifices perfect in regard to conscience, concerning only with foods and drinks and various washing and fleshly ordinances imposed until the time of Reformation. But Christ came as high priest of the good things to come with the greater and the perfect tabernacle not made with hands, that is not of this creation. He's got his own temple now. He's got his own tabernacle. He's in glory. But he's also dwelling amongst his people. So we draw near. We thank God that he's opened up this way. Hebrews chapter 10. And in verse 20 there, Hebrews 10, he says, this is the blood of the covenant which God has commanded you. Oh, sorry, that was the wrong verse. 10, verse 20. He says there, by this a new and a living way which he consecrated for us through the veil that is his flesh. He's opened up the way. The veil is gone. We can come into his presence. We have the assurance that the blood of Jesus Christ can cleanse and cover all our sins. And amazingly now, we have a bridge into the presence of God. I don't need to go and speak to a priest, or you don't need to come to me to talk to God. We can pray directly to God through the Lord Jesus Christ, because he is our great high priest. He is the one in whom we find access to God in Hebrews 10 and in verse 23 again there. We read these words. Well, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering. For he has promised, he is faithful. The bridge is open. The way is clear. We can come into the presence of God. We can pray directly to him. So you can go home today, and I can go home, and we can be praying to him while we're sitting in the chair in the kitchen. We could be praying to him in our bed. We could be praying to him, be careful, but you could be praying to him while you're driving your car. Because we have access into the very presence of God in the name of Jesus Christ. And what he wants us to do, he wants us to hold fast and keep following him. And he wants us to encourage others along the way. Verse 24 of Hebrews 10. And let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works. So the Christian faith, God dwells within the temple of the heart of his people, but we're part of a temple, part of a people. And he wants us to encourage one another in the things of himself, to encourage each other into love and obedience. Don't forsake, he says in verse 25. He says to encourage one another. In verse 25, he says, so do not forsake the assembling of yourselves together, as is the manner of some, but exhorting one another so much more as you see the day approaching. He's telling us, encourage each other. Come together to worship. That's why we made this effort to try to gather you on a Sunday morning and Sunday evening and so forth. Because the Bible tells us it's good for the people of God to dwell together and to worship together. Because he promises to be in the midst of his people. The Day of Atonement. Being made one with God again. That's already been achieved. The system in the Old Testament, it was temporary. The meeting place in the Old Testament was temporary. There was a temporary solution in how to find access to God and how we could know our sins forgiven as we look forward to what was to take place. But the permanent temple and solution is here. Jesus Christ has paid the price. He's opened up the way for us. Now, if I'd have had the hymns on the board, I'd have asked Kylie to put them up and we'd have read verses 2 and 3. We can't do that, but you can actually listen to the words. And I can't remember them off the top of my head, but they were obviously relevant because I've written it down here. So listen to verses 2 and 3 in particular as we think about the fact that before the throne of God above, we have a perfect one who's pleading on our behalf. That's our only hope. Thank you, Kat.
Thank you.
significance then, because we've got no need to despair. You know, you look on your life each week like me and we think, well, I've made a mistake there, I've done this wrong, I've done that wrong. But we look into glory and we think there's a lamb who's been slain for us, who's paid the price for our sin. We've got no reason to despair because he forgives and he covers our sins once and for all. So let's pray. So Father, we thank you that there's great hope found in the gospel for all. There are none too wicked, there are none too far away that they cannot know what it is to have sins forgiven and to be reconciled to you. There's a way back to God from those dark paths of sin. There's a door which is open that all may come in. We thank you that that door is the one who is our bridge between you and ourselves, the one who's covered our sins. Pray that by faith we would have walked through him and know what it is to be reconciled to a holy God. Help us through the week that lies ahead with our failings. Help us to still look to you for that hope which is found in Jesus Christ. Go with us, part us with your blessing, we ask, in your name. Amen.